17 lamb run. Gotta keep a little money. Shout out to Tim Tim. That nigga kill for me.
Before Lil Durk would drop 6 mixtapes, 6 singles, 2 studio albums, and land himself a spot on the 2014 Double XL freshman class list.
2 sisters, 1 brother, 4 empty rooms, no cover.
I got my own style, my own fan base. And nowadays, you hear people sound like me, so that's how you know I'm doing something right.
Before Lil Durk beef with Tyga, The Game, and Chief Keef, and some people were suggesting that he wasn't safe in his native Chirac.
Also, regard to The Game, this, are you gonna reply back or are you leaving that alone?
Fuck that nigga.
Before he would wipe up Dej Loaf on camera, but behind the scenes was with his baby mama, Nicole Cavone. Ugh.
They didn't understand, none of this was planned. 99 problems, but a bitch better not be naying on.
Before Lil Durk would rap alongside Chief Keef, Lil Reese, Young Thug, Logic, Meek Mill, Yo Gotti, French Montana, then join his label Coke Boys before working out his next deal with Def Jam, although I'm not too sure if he's entirely happy with them.
Got a deal, I ain't got shit.
Before Lil Durk's most loyal fans would show off their fandom with OTF tattoos.
What 300 OTF stand for?
I said OTF stand for Only the Family, man. 300 just part of our movement, man.
Durk Banks grew up knowing of only 2 futures, to become a basketball player or become a guy who made money off the streets. By the age of 10, he was already getting heavily involved in street life, and he was good at it. In fact, it was in his genes, because his father once upon a time was a big dealer who got locked up with a life sentence. Durk found himself following in his father's footsteps, but then at 17, he discovered a third option for a future as a rapper. He dropped his debut mixtape, I'm a Hitta, in 2011, and the feedback was positive enough that Durk decided to give rapping a serious go. Unfortunately, the timing wasn't perfect because he had just become a father and gotten himself locked up on gun possession charges.
But it's my style.
What's going on, guys? My name's Mike McCredden, documenting the life and career of Lil Durk prior to fame. Here for you on Before They're Famous. I want to thank SeatGeek for sponsoring this video, and you guys requested this one, and it's been a long time coming. Young M.A., Denzel Curry, and Lil Boosie, they are all on the way, but be sure to let me know in the comments down below who you want me to document next. Was born on October 19th, 1992 in Chicago, Illinois, in the rough and tough neighborhood of Inglewood. Now, if you still don't know how bad this area is, you haven't watched enough of my Before They're Famous videos. Let's take a look at G Herbos. G Herbo has spoken about Chicago as a city that forces young men to grow up quickly. By the age of 12, most boys start thinking like men, and with so much violence and such little opportunity, everyone is constantly looking over their shoulders. Next up, a little baby. He saw his first dead body at 7 years old and quickly grew numb to all the death and violence he was exposed to day in, day out. Rondo number 9. This guy's now in prison. Rondo soon found himself in trouble with the law after posting photos of him holding a legitimate rocket launcher, and those, well, they spread around online. And then there's Al Capone, who sadly passed away. He was walking down an alley on 70th Street and Stony Island Avenue. He was approached by an assailant on foot, and 4 shots were soon fired. Yeah, Inglewood is about as bad as it gets. There, Durk grew up with his 3 sisters. His mother was employed as a nurse, and his father incarcerated since Durk was just 7 months old.
Yeah, I caught $8 million in. A lot, like 6 bricks. Like $8 million of 6 bricks.
Heard that correctly. His dad, Dante Banks, had 6 bricks of crack cocaine worth $8 million when he got arrested. He had a big name in the streets and was given a life sentence when he chose not to rat on gang leader Larry Hoover. His wife and young family had been living lavishly, but following his incarceration, they were forced to move into Durk's grandmother's house. There, 10 people lived in a 3-bedroom home. Little Durk would visit and speak with his father regularly, but with him behind bars, the family had to fend for themselves. Food was hard to come by. A typical meal would be rice or toast, but often there was nothing at all. In 5th grade, Durk started wandering outside, having no father figure to straighten him out, and he went on the streets looking for a way to get himself some dinner. He would hang out with other future members of Chief Keef's Crew Glow Gang, but he formed his own OTF, which stands for Only the Family.
And you from the city of Chicago, huh?
Chicago, man.
Born and raised, man.
Born and raised, shit.
That's what it is, man.
Boy, it's crazy out here. That's why they call it Chirac.
He took an early interest in basketball, but his height never kept up with his skill set. School was out of the question due to awful grades, and with the age of 10, Durk already knew that to make for himself a future, he would have to get to work on the streets. How does that work? What's it entail? Well, it's kind of like this.
You waking up depressed, feeling like shit. You could know you could just go kill him with all the money. Now you got a name, now you extorting motherfuckers. Now motherfuckers give you money off the strength of your name.
He did take an interest in music, with early favorites being Bone Thugs and Harmony, Rick Ross. Then he would watch Meek Mill battle rap on DVD and later on YouTube.
Nigga, fuck a lookout. It's Meek Mill, I heat a nigga grill like a cookout. Don't make me bring my book out.
It wasn't until he turned 17 that he started making music himself. He began working with his childhood friends, Sly Polaroid and King Louie. He put together his first mixtape, I'm a Hitta with D-Gangs. All the songs got leaked, but Lil Durk saw success on his MySpace page when songs like Hitta and Sneak Dissin' were getting like 300,000 listens. That's a lot of listens. Or views. I don't know how MySpace works.
Listen on your status, Facebook could get you damaged. We ain't only rude, boy. Let him run, my nigga savage.
Lil Durk had found something that he was good at, that he could build a life around and provide for his family. The timing was great too because he had just fathered his first child with baby mama Nicole Cavone. But then Durk was arrested on weapons charges in October of 2011 after he was pulled over for drinking in his vehicle and police discovered he was in possession of a gun. He served 3 months in Vandalia State Prison before he was released on bond, only to return to prison for 87 more days. During this time, he had a lot of thinking to do. Also, they cut his hair, he was pissed. He had a son to feed now, and he didn't want his child to grow up like he did. He saw the potential of a rap career and made plans to buckle down and make his rap career work. Not only for him, but also for his family. Plus, he didn't want people to keep cutting his hair. Following his release, Durk got back to work, this time with Paris Bueller, dropping the mixtape I'm Still a Hitta and the track L's Anthem. Well, it picked up some serious steam and was remixed featuring French Montana.
L's up for them hitters. Throw the L's up for them hitters.
Lil Durk quickly became a local legend and people were stopping him to take pictures. His numbers on MySpace and YouTube were going up and up, and Durk celebrated by having another child. He joined French Montana's Coke Boys and in 2012 signed with Def Jam along with Lil Reese. He celebrated with his family at Chicago's club Deja Vu. He scored an underground hit with This Ain't What You Want, a middle finger to cops, snitches, and media, and well, basically anyone trying to bring him down.
This ain't what they want. See, this rap shit ain't shit to me.
Then his fourth mixtape, Signed to the Streets, was included in Rolling Stone's 2013 roundup for the year's top 10 best. With all that great stuff happening, well then Lil Durk went and got busted. Again.
I got the police all into me. This ain't what they want.
Lil Durk wasn't kidding when he rapped that the cops had their eyes on the rising star. On June 5th, 2013, he was arrested after allegedly throwing a loaded .40 caliber handgun into his car when police approached him on South Green Street in Chicago. He was charged with unlawful use of a weapon by a felon, he was held on a $100,000 bond, and his lawyer would claim to have 9 affidavits from witnesses who confirmed Durk's innocence. One witness even admitted that the gun was his. Durk was released on July 18, 2013, and once again, he got back to work.
Still be living in the hood, still doing the same shit. I'm saying that's backwards. You do better to change, not change to the same.
In 2014, he made the freshman class list for XXL and dropped his follow-up, Signed to the Streets 2. He's since gone on to drop 2 albums and more mixtapes, and has bought himself a nice house in the suburbs. Also, he's had another child, at least one, and this time with another lady. The kid's moving up in the world.
Yeah, this is our new house. About 3 days ago. I'm saying we ain't really started decorating it yet. When we do, it's definitely gonna feel like home.
New laws have been passed, so his father might be getting out of prison soon as well. But it hasn't been all good news for Lil Durk. He's suffered several devastating losses, and 2 people, especially close to him, were killed due to gun violence. His cousin, MacArthur Swindle, was killed in June of 2014, and his manager, Uchana Aguina, he was gunned down in March of 2015. That's why you gotta enjoy the time with those you love when you can. I recommend taking them to a Lil Durk concert, or any concert or sporting event. I want to introduce you guys to SeatGeek. Boom! This is the world's largest event ticket search engine. What they do is search all the ticket prices available on the web to find the absolute best seat at the best price. SeatGeek puts out a 1 to 100 score to let you know if you're getting a good deal or a bad one. Green means good, bad means no. Now, because you guys are truthfully amazing subscribers, I worked out a deal to get you guys 20 bucks back when you use the promo code FAMOUS. You know you're gonna buy tickets, so you might as well do it now. A link is in the description box down below. I picked up some for UFC out in New York City, and I got some for my old man to watch a TFC game. That's Toronto Football Club. He's Irish, he loves that shit. As for the rest of the story, well, you know the story because this is Before They're Famous. My name is Michael McCrudden, and you guys requested this video, so I made it for you. Be sure to let me know in the comments down below who you want me to document next. Denzel Curry. Gonna go write that right now. Young M.A., we're gonna film that tomorrow. All right, guys, I'll see you in another video. With his baby mama, Nicole Cavone. Ugh. She's not good. She's not good.
But it's my style.